Okay, Daryl Chandler is our missionary tonight, and he was born on February 22nd in 1932 in Salt Lake City. Now, Salt Lake City is in the United States, right about there, and you guys can come up and look at this more afterwards. And if you look at the United States, Salt Lake City is right here. And he was born and raised in Salt Lake City. And then he went to Bible College, where he met his wife, Louise Grings. And they got married when he was only 19 years old, in 1951. Louise was raised in the Belgian Congo with her missionary parents. So here is the Congo, the Belgian Congo. And that's where she was raised. She was actually born in Florida when they were home on furlough, but that's where she was raised with her missionary parents, and she had three brothers and a sister. I'll try and stand still. I know that that's important. She had come to the United States for her Bible college education, and that's where they met, because she wanted to be a missionary too, just like her parents had met. And so she came to get her education, and that's where they met. And they were both determined to follow God to the ends of the earth, whatever it took, wherever God was going to send them. So after they finished Bible college, they started driving across the United States from Salt Lake toward New York City over here to raise money for going on their missions trip, okay? They had a one-year-old son by that time, and his name was David. And they also had Louise's younger brother along, whose name was Mark Grings, and he wanted to be a missionary too. So they wanted churches to provide them a monthly financial support, just like our church provides support to missionaries, so that they could go to Africa. They wanted to serve God in the areas that Louise's parents hadn't been able to reach yet. Okay? 6 months later, after they even borrowed a car, they didn't even have a car of their own. They borrowed a car and went across the United States and worked their way to New York City, and they gathered, finally, $168 a month from the churches, and then they sailed off for the Congo in June of 1954. Now, to put that in perspective, I was 4 years old at that time. Okay? So these people were about the age of my parents. And of course, my parents have gone on to heaven now, and so has Daryl Chandler, but his wife is still living. Okay, $168 wasn't a whole lot of money, even in those days. And on top of that, the Chandlers only used $28 a month for themselves. The rest of it, $140 a month, they put into the missions of building churches and schools. So now they're in Africa, and now they're known as jungle rats. Jungle rats?
Rats.
Why would they be called jungle rats? What does that mean? Well, they were called that because they lived in mud huts, in a mud hut with a grass roof and a dirt floor, just like the natives. They ate the food of the natives, and they hunted wild meat animals for their own meat. Daryl got so good at hunting that he never missed. He could kill an animal with one shot. Because you see, bullets were expensive, so he learned to get really good at conserving his bullets. He never missed. Some of the animals that he shot were wild boar. Here's a picture of the wild boar right down here. They're really big animals. You get to come up and see it afterwards. Cape buffalo. And do I have another picture? Over here is the antelope. It's called the Mbendi antelope. I had to look at it because it's an African name. Mbendi antelope, okay? And on the floor of their hut had a woven mat that the native women had made for them out of reeds. Why would they need a woven mat on the floor? You'll never believe. Go ahead, take a guess.
Because the dirt floor would have, like, bugs in it.
Well, you're really close. It had termites in it.
Oh.
Thousands of termites. And so they put the mat down on the floor so that the termites wouldn't get on them. And if they accidentally left their shoes lay on the floor for a couple of days, if you went to pick them up, they'd fall apart in your hand because the termites would eat them up. They'd eat up everything they could eat. So they'd probably eat on my sandals, they'd eat all of that top leather part and maybe leave the bottom part. Ugh, huh, yes, yes. Ugh. One of the most exciting, there were no doors and only open windows. And the open windows had no glass and no screens. So any kind of an animal or insect or spider or a snake could come in. And they had a small child, so how were they going to protect him? How would he even sleep at night? Well, first of all, they trusted God to protect him. And time again, Daryl wrote a book. I forgot to bring it in with me, but Mr. Robertson has it out there. He wrote a book, and he talked about their experiences. And time again, God protected the children and them with all kinds of stuff. So the second thing that they did, which was a little bit more practical, is they built David a box bed. And then all of the children that came out afterwards got a box bed. And you might say, what is a box bed? Well, it had a wooden frame on legs. It stood up off the floor. And it had a wooden platform with a mattress on top of it. And it had a wooden roof. And then it had sides that had screens in them, and it had a little door on the side that latched shut so that the child would be protected. And so every night they would put him in there and latch the door. And if he had to get up and go to the bathroom, they'd go get him out and take him to the bathroom and then put him back in there. But the screen kept the mosquitoes and everything else out. Yes?
Would he breathe?
Because the screens. It wasn't closed, it was the screens. Okay, so now I have a picture of an old-time box bed that was in Austria. I couldn't find an exact one. And it's all wooden, but these weren't. The baby could see out and people could see in. It was screens, like a screen door on the sides, okay? So that's how they protected the babies from any animal that would slither in or come through the window. You know, that's how they protected them. One of the most exciting and scary things happened when they were in the Congo when Daryl had to shoot and kill a rogue elephant. And that's the elephant story, okay? Now, a rogue animal is one that has become unpredictable and is acting strangely. It's not acting like its normal self. This elephant had been wounded in the shoulder and it had become infected and sore. He became so irritable and disagreeable that his own group, his own herd, kicked him out. They didn't want him around because he was grumpy. And that was because he didn't feel good, okay? He went on rampages and destroyed the natives' gardens and their houses and their water supply. And one time, he almost mowed down a whole group of them. He almost killed a whole group of them. That rogue elephant needed to be stopped, okay? So Daryl and two of his natives that he was friends with, that were hunters, set out to bring that rogue elephant down. They chased the elephant, and the elephant chased them. And the elephant hid from them. You go, wait a minute, how can an elephant hide? Well, the elephant has a skin that's a particular gray color that when it's standing in half shade, half sun, it just blends right in. And it could be this close to you and you wouldn't see it. And so that's kind of scary. And elephants are very, very smart. When they're feeling good, they'll almost play games with you. And they can learn language. You've seen them in circuses, maybe. And they will take commands from people. They're very, very smart. And this rogue elephant was doing a very good job of eluding those hunters. It took him 5 hours, and Daryl only had 20 bullets. And he had fired and fired and fired at this elephant, trying to bring him down. The only place you can hit an elephant to truly bringing down to death and know that he's dead is right here in the temple. Well, Daryl couldn't get a good temple shot. He kept trying to get a shot to the temple. He shot him and shot him and shot him. He used up 19 bullets. How many bullets did he have?
20.
How many does he have left?
One.
And that thing is still going. Finally, he got a chance to shoot him right in the temple. And the elephant crumpled down on the ground. And he died. And it was very sad that he died. He was a beautiful, kingly elephant. But the terror that he caused was finally over. He was a rogue elephant. And the elephant then provided meat. They butchered him, and that meat was provided to the rest of the village for weeks. He was so big, he fed the whole village for weeks. One of the beliefs that the natives had was that they could not eat certain things. Those were called taboos. Say that with me, taboos. No. So some groups were not allowed to eat chicken. Some of the taboos ran in families. And so for generations, a family could be forbidden to eat a certain fish. Or maybe for another family, it could be antelope. Once the taboo had been established, they believed if you ate it, the demon spirits would kill you. Mm-hmm. That's what they believed. Well, one of the men who became a Christian said it was a shame that the name of Christ, it was a shame upon the name of Christ to keep a taboo because of fear of the demon spirits. So he called a whole bunch of the men together, and right there in front of them all, he ate the food that was a taboo for his family. He ate it. What do you think happened?
He got killed.
He didn't believe in the demon spirits anymore. He trusted Christ as the Savior. He didn't die. Nothing happened. Nothing whatsoever happened. And so from that time on, any Christian, anybody who was a new Christian was ready to get baptized. Before they got baptized, the Christian men would get together and interview you to find out what the taboo was for your family. And you were required to eat your taboo to prove that you really were born again and that you really trusted Christ and not the demon spirits. Okay? You didn't get to get baptized if you didn't eat your taboo for your family. Okay? The chaplains were in the Congo for 10 years. They had two more children, Jonathan and Deborah. Now, Jonathan is married to Mr. Robertson's sister, Sherry, Reggie's aunt. Okay, so that makes Jonathan his uncle, right? Yes, that makes Jonathan his uncle. Okay, they established 13 churches and 7 Christian schools and trained 36 national preachers. What's a national preacher? It's a preacher who was a native to that area, who became a Christian and got trained up to be a preacher. And they trained 36 of those men to be preachers. But in 1964, there was a terrible civil war. All 13 churches and 7 school buildings got burned down to the ground. And 20 of those 36 pastors were murdered. And hundreds of the Christians, the native Christians, were killed. Hundreds of them. The ones that managed to escape had to run for their lives, and they hid in the jungles, deep, deep, deep in the jungles, where the revolutionaries couldn't find them. Okay? And so then, the chaplains were evacuated and sent back to the United States, and the Congo government wouldn't let any foreigners back into the country for years and years and years and years to come. So the mission's door to the Congo was shut. They couldn't go back to the Congo. So they prayed about it, and in May of 1965, just 1 year later, they decided to go to the jungles of Suriname in South America. So here's South America. Here's where Suriname is located, this little purple country. And this is what Suriname looks like if you expand it. And they were in this area right here, okay? Oh, by the way, this Congo area, that's what this looks like expanded. And they were in this little area that's highlighted, okay? But they went out to all these villages around, okay? They went to lots of villages around. Okay, so then in 1965, they went to Suriname, and the people there were called Maroons. Say Maroons with me.
Maroons.
Okay, and they were descendants of African slaves. So they were still from Africa. They were the descendants of African people. So they were still African people, just on another continent. Instead of being here, they're here. So if you look on it on this great big map, instead of being here, they're here. Because this is a world map, see it? So this takes them from Salt Lake to the Congo, and now over here to Suriname. Okay? The Champlin's fourth child, Ethan, was born just that same year that they got to Suriname. And because they were familiar with the African people and their beliefs, they were able to witness through them, to them, through medical missions. Okay, they established a clinic and people came to get healed, and so they were able to witness to them. One of the most exciting things that happened in Suriname was a confrontation with a witch doctor. The unsaved leadership of the village did not like it that where people were getting saved. They called for the witch doctor to come and stop Daryl's influence and stop him from telling people about Jesus. So what they did is they broke a bunch of bottles and crushed it up into small pieces of glass. And then they built a fire. And the witch doctor went into a trance. He was under demonic control. Demonic control means that Satan was controlling him. And then he danced through the glass and through the fire. And when he got done, there was no damage to his feet at all. Nothing. Not a scratch. Not a little burn. Nothing. So he boasted that his was the true and only power. Do you know what? The Lord spoke to Daryl and he said, I want you to do that too. What? You want me to walk through the glass and the fire? Do you think Daryl did it?
Yes.
He did. He obeyed God. He walked across the glass and through the fire. Do you think he was cut?
No.
No. Do you think he was burned?
No.
No, he wasn't. No harm was done. Isn't that amazing? So the next day, a bunch of men came to his hut and they said, we want to see your feet. And he stuck his feet up. No damage at all. And they said, wow, your God is all powerful. Tell us the way and we will walk in it. They wanted to get saved. And they did. Isn't that wonderful? The Champlin stayed in Suriname for over 50 years. And their children, their four children, are all grown now. And they have children and children. And they all serve the Lord there too. They established 9 churches, 11 chapels, a Bible institute, and 2 medical clinics. The third ministry that Daryl Champlin did in his life was that he served the Lord by preaching about missions at various churches around in the United States, and he also taught classes in some of the Bible colleges. His most famous message is on the internet, and it has spread around the globe. It is called Love with Shoes On. Jesus asked Peter, do you love me? He asked it 3 times. Finally, Peter got what Jesus was asking. Jesus was asking Peter if he was really, if he was ready for the stonings, the beatings, the ridicule, the scorn, the sufferings, and even being killed for Jesus. Was he willing to be a soldier to march in that war? Jesus was asking him, will you love me with shoes on? Did Daryl Champlin love the Lord with shoes on? Yes, he was willing to suffer whatever it took. And he did. He suffered threats to his life by the natives. He suffered threats to his life by those wild big animals. He suffered many jungle diseases. When you read his book, I'm just telling you just a little tiny bit about him, but there are all kinds of jungle diseases that he and his family had to survive. And he lived without the comforts of the life that we know. They didn't have a toilet. They didn't have running water. They didn't have air conditioning, and it was hot there. He didn't have a house. He had a dirt floor with termites, okay? So he didn't have any of the comforts of life as we know them. He served with shoes on until he went to be with the Lord almost 3 years ago. He died in August of 2015, and this is 2018, okay? And his wife is still there in Suriname serving the Lord with her children. So I'm going to ask you a question. Do you love the Lord? Do you love him with shoes on? In other words, are you willing to suffer what Jesus was saying to Peter? Are you willing to suffer the ridicule, the scorn, whatever it takes to love Jesus? Let's have a prayer, okay? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for these attentive children that were in here today. And Father, I just thank you for how Daryl Champlin served you and the example that he sets for us. And Lord, there is no higher calling to be a missionary. And Lord, I just pray that some of these children decide to do that, to go and serve you with shoes on. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.